Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Resources for the Future, and welcome to one of our first Wednesday seminars. And I might say today is a special day. Welcome to the nation's capital, where we are learning who is essential and who is not in terms of employment here in the city. But I think we all know in this country that water is an essential resource, and there are many complex issues ahead in how we manage that effectively for a host of values that are at stake when we deal with this resource. Well, today we have a superb panel, and I particularly wanted to thank Brad Udall and Tom Brown, both of whom have come in from Colorado to join us. Both are renowned in their own rights and will be introduced in a moment, but they made an extra effort here that we certainly appreciate. But I'm simply going to introduce, and very delighted to do so, and put into her capable hands our moderator, Lynn Scarlett. Lynn has been a visiting scholar here at RFF. She's been a co-chair of our Center for Management of Ecosystem Services. She held the second highest rank within the Department of Interior, and so she's an incredibly knowledgeable and skilled and experienced individual. But now she's taken on a new position, a brand new position created at TNC, the Nature Conservancy, where she's going to be manager of public policy. And I probably should point out that the CEO of TNC, Mark Tersig, is a member of RFF's board of directors, and so we have several projects actually with them as well. Well, let me turn it over to Lynn, and I think we're going to have a great session today.
Thank you, Phil, and welcome. Welcome. I'm really delighted to be back at Resources for the Future. I've been at my new position at the Nature Conservancy for 12 days, so I'm still very much in learning mode. I want to give a few comments to set the stage for this panel, really an outstanding panel, and then I will, prior to their turning the podium over to them, I will introduce each of them. But let me give a few remarks to set the stage. While not all of the issues that I faced while I was at the Interior Department for 8 years were water issues, many of the most contentious included water as a central source of conflict. The Klamath Basin hit the headlines shortly after I arrived in Washington. There we saw hydropower, endangered species, irrigation, fisheries, and tribal heritage all converging on a collision course essentially centered on water. Glen Canyon Dam, Lake Powell, Lake Mead, all faced contests over power supplies, irrigation, recreation, endangered species, and cultural resources. Even in the East, Interior found itself amid battles among Georgia, Florida, and Alabama over water flows in the Apalachicola, Chattahoochee, and Flint watersheds. I just love to say those words. You throw a dart on the map and essentially we see communities that face water challenges. I remember the U.S. Geological Survey presenting me with such a map that showed headlines from all across the country that involved water issues, and there was not a place untouched. Now, those challenges are, of course, not new, but several trends complicate 21st century water management challenges. These include aging infrastructure, fragmented management jurisdictions and landscapes, persistent non-point source pollution, highly degraded ecosystems, and of course, one must not forget the effects of a changing climate. Now, it's within this setting that the Bureau of Reclamation, the Forest Service, water experts like Brad Udall, our experts here from Resources for the Future, Len Shabman and Yusuke, have examined the issue of water in the West, in the Colorado River Basin, in the nation as a whole. Now, their work highlights the profound need for comprehensive and linked information about water availability and water consumption. Information that includes both surface water and groundwater being an arena in which Yusuke has paid particular attention. We simply cannot manage well the waters of our community, states, and the nation without such information. Today, our speakers highlight uncertainties and even the unpredictable nature of climate effects on water, especially at a local scale. The effects of climate change on water supplies and use may be significant over time. They include, for example, potential changes in the amount of precipitation, changes in the timing of precipitation, changes in the form of precipitation, that is, rain versus snow, potential changes in the distribution of precipitation, changes in rainfall intensity potentially, and also the frequency of intense rainfall events. Now, those effects come with some corollary effects. Specifically, we may see changes in the duration, extent, distribution, intensity, and frequency of drought. We may also see changes in groundwater-surface water interactions. We may see changes in the volume and velocity of runoff, impacts on water quality. But what's the bottom line of that brief overview of those potential changes? Well, changes in water flows, timing, and form are highly complex, location-specific, and highly dynamic. For water managers, there are certain implications. We must reconsider, for example, water supply infrastructure, including reservoir operations, flood control, and stormwater management that arise from changes in flows, intensity, and timing of precipitation. We must perhaps enhance efforts to address water quality and the ways in which we do so. Many sources of energy are water intensive, and indeed water delivery systems are often high energy users. Changes in the availability of water may stretch the capacity of existing compacts and rights allocations. Several planning and management tools become increasingly important within this setting. In a context of climate change, increasing water demands, and pressures to improve water quality, I think six water management strategies may become increasingly relevant and find their ways onto the management portfolio. These include such things as more flexible river and reservoir management, urban infrastructure greening, market-based water pricing, something that RFF has worked on for many, many years, perhaps decades, water marketing, water quality trading, and the scale in which we manage water. Now, water managers face a question of whether to reintroduce more natural river system functioning, for example, and flow patterns to meet human needs while improving ecological functioning and climate resilience. Tools to achieve these goals may include flexible river management systems, to which I just alluded. Among some of the best examples of such management are a handful of projects, partnerships between the Nature Conservancy, where I now work, and the Army Corps of Engineers along river systems. Systems in Vermont, New Hampshire, North Carolina, and elsewhere. Now, another strategy to address water needs in a changing context is urban greening. I mentioned that a moment ago. Urban water use and water management often remain locked within limitations of old infrastructure. This infrastructure has contributed to increased stormwater runoff and has not facilitated, for example, water conservation. Most city infrastructure distributes potable drinking water for all urban water needs, from drinking water to laundry to toilet flushing to landscape irrigation. Some U.S. water consumption patterns may also be linked to low-priced water rates. Several cities have begun to use tiered block pricing, with rates climbing as use climbs also. Another policy tool is watershed permitting and trading, watershed scale permitting and trading. The benefits of water quality trading can sometimes be considerable. One example that I like is in the Tualatin Basin in Oregon, where four wastewater treatment permits and one stormwater permit were required. The Water Services District needed additional measures to meet water temperature standards. Their primary options included spending some $60 million on a refrigeration system, or spending $6 million to pay farmers to plant trees along about 37 miles of streams using a permit credits approach. Now, the example illustrates the potential both of a watershed approach and the utility of water quality credits and trading potentially. Now, I want to conclude my discussion of water futures with a summary of major impending challenges. First, the dispersed authorities, multiple agencies, and diverse jurisdictions make coordination and integration difficult. Yet the challenges of water management do require greater integration. Second, permitting and standards premised on mechanical and gray engineering solutions present an ill fit in a context of transition to more flexible, resilient, and greening infrastructure. A third challenge related to the first is our institutional and legal structures. Water rights and water allocations emerged in circumstances prevalent 100 years ago. As I contemplate water futures, I see the Klamath Basin and elsewhere as precursors to the kinds of complexities we can expect. In these contexts, tools that enhance flexibility and resilience may be gaining increasing significance. That toolkit includes, as I said before, water quality trading, water supply trading, in-stream flow enhancements, new pricing tools. The toolkit includes constructs that enhance network or shared governance, which are increasingly important to transcend those jurisdictional boundaries. But perhaps also we must reorient how we think about ecosystems or nature. Ecosystems, as resources for the future's Jim Boyd and others have so persuasively shown, provide services to human communities. The health of ecosystems is thus tied to the well-being of those communities. Their loss is not free. Their loss invokes requirements for replacement services in the form of water filtration services, levees, refrigeration, the list goes on. RFF's Len Shabman, here on the panel, has worked with others to help Florida implement a pioneering Florida Ranchland Ecosystem Services project. Through that project, farmers receive payments to store water and engage other management practices to achieve water quality and water storage, perhaps a precursor of what we might see elsewhere in the country. So with that, I'm going to conclude with the words of the famous philosopher Yogi Berra, who once said, "The future ain't what it used to be." I now want to introduce our panelists, and I want to join Phil Sharp, RFF's president, in really thanking our two panelists that have come all the way from Colorado. And also thank all of you in the audience, including some who may be on vacation at the moment, unplanned. Our first panelist is Dr. Thomas Brown. He is an economist at the Rocky Mountain Research Station of the U.S. Forest Service. He's been a member of that research station staff since 1974. He's focused on methodologies for economic valuation of natural resources and the environmental, economic, and institutional aspects of water resource management. His recent work includes an assessment of past and projected future water use in the United States, projections of the vulnerability of the U.S. water supply to shortage, and also he's worked on the book In-Stream Flow Protection, Seeking a Balance Between and in Western Water Use. He has a PhD in water management and economics from the University of Arizona. I'm going to run through all the introductions so that we can then flow seamlessly along with the panelists. Our second panelist is Brad Udall. Brad is director of the Getchess Wilkinson Center for Natural Resources, Energy, and the Environment at the University of Colorado Law School. Brad is a longtime friend. We had the opportunity to serve together on the Udall Foundation in Tucson. Brad's experience is in the science and policy of water and climate change with a focus on the American Southwest. He's a contributing author to the fifth Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report. He wrote the water chapter in the recent 2013 Southwest Climate Assessment out by Island Press. He's a member of the U.S. Department of the Interior's new Federal Advisory Committee on Climate Change Science and Adaptation. He's also a co-investigator for the DOI Southwest Climate Science Center. He spent extensive time in Australia looking at their unprecedented drought in recent times and their innovative water reforms. Before being at the Getchess Wilkinson Center, he was a principal investigator for 10 years at the University of Colorado NOAA Western Water Assessment. And then I turn to our two Resources for the Future panelists, Yusuke Kuoyama. He is a fellow here at RFF. He focuses his research on the economics of environmental regulation with an emphasis on water resources and ecosystems. His work seeks to understand how the interaction between economic and natural systems affects the efficiency of policy instruments. He's done a great deal of work on groundwater. He examines the cost-effectiveness of policies to manage spatially heterogeneous externalities. That's a mouthful. from agricultural water use, the implications of time lags and uncertainty, some of the topics that I mentioned earlier in informing hydrologic models. And then we have Len Shabman. Len, a resident scholar at Resources for the Future. I mentioned Len's work in Florida. He joined Resources for the Future a little over a decade ago, 2002, after 3 decades on the faculty at Virginia Tech. His research and communication efforts are focused on programs and responsibilities for flood and coastal storm risk management, design of payment for ecosystem services programs, development of evaluation protocols for ecosystem restoration. The list of his work goes on. He's been engaged in Everglades, coastal Louisiana, Chesapeake Bay. He has looked at issues pertaining to permitting under Section 404 of the Clean Water Act, market-based incentives for water quality management. And in 2004, Len was named an associate of the National Academy of Sciences. So with that, the order will go in. We'll start with Tom. Then we'll go to Brad, then Yusuke, and then Len. And why don't you just come up one after the other? Or if you prefer to sit where you are, that's fine too. So Tom?
Here, I'll let me slide in and you.
Well, I'm very glad to be here.
Can you turn down the lights so we can see you?
Yeah, I think they're working on that.
As you can see, I work for the Rocky Mountain Research Station of the Forest Service. However, as you probably understand, I'm here today as a private citizen. And as a faculty affiliate at Colorado State University. My two collaborators are Jorge Ramirez on this study, are Jorge Ramirez at Colorado State and Romano Foti, who is now at Princeton. They are both hydrologists. I was the economist on the project. You might ask why the Forest Service is doing a study about water supply across the U.S., and the answer is because of the Renewable Resources Planning Act Congress passed in the 70s, directing the Forest Service to every 10 years project resource supply and demand conditions for renewable natural resources. Our most recent report was released last year and covers forests, rangelands, wildlife and fish, recreation opportunities, and water. And a study by the Forest Service about U.S. water supply certainly couldn't have been done without a lot of information from other agencies. You see them listed at the bottom, and principal among them is the U.S. Geological Survey. Our goal was to determine where and to what extent future water shortages would occur in the absence of major new adaptation measures. Lynn was just talking about mentioning quite a few adaptation measures, things that should be considered for dealing with shortages or water quality problems. Our study was really about where at those measures are most going to be needed and when. Our approach was to estimate the likelihood of water shortages in basins throughout the contiguous U.S. under alternative future socioeconomic and climatic conditions. And I'll be saying more about that. I'll briefly summarize the approach, talk about how we estimated water supply, water demand, and then present our results on the future vulnerability. Oh, thank you. I must have pushed the wrong button. So I want to make clear that we're not predicting the future. Rather, we are determining the likelihood of future water shortages in the absence of new adaptations. Thus, we seek to show where adaptation is going to be needed. And in light of the inherent uncertainty about the future, we did two important things. First of all, we're estimating the probability of shortages in the different basins we look at across the country, where a shortage is a situation where projected demand exceeds projected supply. We're using demand and supply in a general sense, not in a strict economic sense. And secondly, we obtain estimates of vulnerability for 9 different possible futures, corresponding to 3 IPCC emission scenarios that specify, in a broad sense, population and economic growth. And with each of the climate of each of those simulated using 3 different global climate models, GCMs. So we begin with IPCC scenarios, which specify population, income, et cetera, and then we updated that information and disaggregated it across the U.S. and simulated the climate. And that, so those are our beginning conditions, and we estimated water supply by first estimating water yield. That's precipitation minus natural evapotranspiration off the landscape. And then that water yield is subjected to management. It's stored in reservoirs, diverted in canals and tunnels from one basin to the other. And the result of that management is water supply, the amount of water available for upstream use. Water demand also begins with estimates of the basic drivers, including population and income, and climate. And we looked at a lot of historical information about water use to, in order to be able to estimate future desired water use, and I'll show you more about that. So we end up with essentially a PDF of water supply and a PDF of water demand. The likelihood of different levels of water supply and water demand, and from that we get the probability of shortages or vulnerability. For supply, we assumed that the existing infrastructure would remain in place and that there were no additions to it. And we assumed that only renewable water was available for use. So we're not including the possibility of groundwater mining, meaning the lowering of the water tables of deep aquifers. For water demand, we extended past trends in water withdrawal per unit of driver or per user, and we adopted the Department of Energy projections on electricity production from renewable sources. And we modeled demand and supply for these 98 basins across the U.S. They were originally defined or delineated by the Water Resources Council in the 70s. So this is our spatial scale. So water supply in a given basin, it's called an ASR for assessment subregion, is equal to the water yield that occurs in that basin in a given year, plus inflow from upstream basins, plus net transbasin diversions in canals and tunnels into that basin, plus water left in the basin from the previous year in reservoir storage, minus the required in-stream flow. And on the bottom you see the levels of reservoir storage of the different basins, and on the right bottom you see the interconnections among the basins. There's natural flow from upstream to downstream, but also in the U.S. a complicated set of canals and pipelines that allow water to be diverted where it otherwise wouldn't go. Importantly, now this graph shows 2 of the 9 projections. This is showing the change from current situation to 2060. 2 of the 9 projections of water yield, precipitation minus natural evapotranspiration. And the other 7 look largely the same, and the message here is that under climate change, water yield is projected to decrease, largely because of an increase in temperature leading to an increase in natural evapotranspiration off of the landscape, leaving less water to enter the stream or the near groundwater. There are also changes in precipitation going on here. Is it projected to go up in some places and down in others? But those effects are pretty much overwhelmed by the increase in evapotranspiration. So that is supply. Moving on to demand. Demand was that equal to what's called consumptive use. That's the portion of withdrawal that doesn't return to the stream. So it's used up, essentially evaporated or incorporated into products during the current time step. And withdrawal was estimated as a demand unit, it could be a person for domestic use, times the withdrawal per unit, say, per person. And demand was estimated for those six water use sectors you see on the right, and then summed up to a total demand, a total amount of desired consumptive use. Interestingly, looking at the withdrawal rates, on the left half of each of these four graphs, you see the historical record. On the right half of these are projections for very large areas here. I'm just summarizing for the eastern and western U.S. And in all four cases, in most areas, the withdrawal rates have been declining. For example, in the upper left, in the east, domestic and public use per capita has been dropping since 1995. In the west, it's sort of flattened off and it seems to be beginning to decrease. In the upper right, industrial and commercial use per dollar of income in the economy has dropped dramatically. A lot of that is because of loss of heavy manufacturing, but it's also because of more recycling by the industries and businesses using the water. Thermoelectric use per kilowatt hour produced has also been going down because of technological changes. And irrigation. In the West, the withdrawal per acre irrigated has been going down. So these are largely adaptations that are already happening, adaptations to water shortages, plus other exogenous effects like the loss of heavy manufacturing. Adding these up for the whole country, you can see that withdrawal since about 1985 has been fairly flat for the U.S. as a whole and is projected to continue to be so, assuming no climate change. And that's despite a consistently increasing population. On the bottom line, you see consumptive use, which is what we're calling demand here and what we're modeling. And it's projected to increase gradually, but not dramatically, over time in the absence of climate change. These are for the whole U.S. now, but the effects vary geographically. Oh, I'm sorry. I just wanted to point out one more thing. This is the breakdown among the sectors for consumptive use, which is the important demand variable here. And you can see that irrigation accounts for almost all of it. About 80% of the consumptive use nationwide now is for agriculture. The other sectors are relatively minor. Now moving to the spatial disaggregation across the basins, the 98 basins we looked at, you see that in the west is where consumptive use is projected to decrease if the climate does not change. And that's largely because of a projected decrease in agricultural area, which, as you see in the bottom right, has been happening since about 1980. And is projected to continue. At least that's what we projected, although it's very difficult to tell, really. So this is without climate change, and this is demand with climate change. And the reason is largely that increasing temperatures are projected to increase plant water use on irrigated agricultural fields and also in landscape maintenance. There are other reasons we looked at, but that's the main one. And it's quite a different picture, future demand or desired consumptive use as the climate changes. So putting those two together, we get our results, our estimates of vulnerability, of the probability that demand would be greater than supply in the absence of adaptation. And this is the result for one of the three scenarios, the IPCC scenarios, called the A1B. And it's shown here for the three different global climate models that we use for simulating future temperature and precipitation. And you see here that there's quite a large difference among the three models, indicating a lot of uncertainty, really, about the specifics. But generally, the story here is that modeling at this large scale with these 98 basins at the annual time step, the most vulnerable areas are in the larger southwest. Here's the results for the A2 scenario. The A2 scenario is warmer and has a higher population than the A1B, and as a result, the vulnerability levels are higher. And finally, these are the results for the B2 scenario for three GCMs, not quite as onerous as the A2 scenario, but still presenting the same general picture. And now I just finally show you a picture of the minimum vulnerability level projected for 2060 in each ASR on the left, and the maximum for each ASR on the right. So sort of the best case scenario on the left, worst case scenario on the right, and a large difference between them, again indicating how much uncertainty there is about the specific levels that of vulnerability that will occur in the absence of adaptation. So just to wrap up, we've found that population increases alone will not cause a large increase in water demand because of decreasing water withdrawal rates and reductions in irrigated area in the West, that climate change will decrease water supply and increase water demand, and that vulnerability increases are caused by a combination of those two things. Much uncertainty remains about the specific level of vulnerability for most basins. In general, the larger Southwest, including parts of California and the western side, and the central and southern Great Plains on the eastern side, are the most vulnerable. Shortages would lead to increased pressures to decrease in-stream flow and increase groundwater mining, along with other adaptation measures. And those additional measures will be essential. And I didn't get into the details here because of time, but we found that large increases in reservoir storage capacity are typically not the answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll go straight to Brad's presentation. We'll have questions at the very end of all four panels.
So, let's see, we need to. Yeah, maybe.
So, Lynn gave you a long bio about me, but most people just want to know which you all am I related to. And so I'll make your job easy, and actually I can do a little question for you. So Phil Sharp was actually in the Congress for 18 years and served with my father when he was chairman of the House Interior Committee. And so that makes my father Mo, and my brother Mark, and my cousin Tom, and my uncle Stuart, which is sort of a whole mouthful. When I give a talk about the Colorado River, as I'm going to do here, I like to tell people that I'm actually the great-great-grandson of John D. Lee, Lee being the founder of Lee's Ferry, the all-important dividing line between the upper and lower basin in the Colorado River. And you might think that that's kind of fun, and it is, but Lee had 21 wives. And so we think he now has about 800,000 descendants. And it's not all that unusual to be a relative of the old John D. Lee. So Tom's last slide actually is a great segue into my talk, because if you know your U.S. geography, that big brown area there was the Colorado River, right? I mean, that's the ground zero in many cases for what we think about climate change. And I'll just note a few things here. If you want this presentation, there's a tiny URL there. I'm happy to send it to you if you can't find that. And my opening graph here actually comes out of a study that Reclamation just completed called the Basin Study. And this study came out of the Secure Water Act, the only federal law that we have that deals with climate change adaptation. And it forces Reclamation to do a whole bunch of things, include studies about future supplies and demands. And these numbers here go all the way back to 1920. Here's water use in the Colorado River, and here's the supply. And you can see right around the turn of the 21st century, we had an interesting crossing point. And that obviously can't last for very long, right? You could do it for a while if you have very big reservoirs. But this future projection that came out of this study indicates about a 3 million acre foot imbalance going out to 2060. And an acre foot is this weird unit that we use in the West to describe water. It's about the size of an Olympic swimming pool. It's 1 foot on top of 1 acre of land. It came out of the agricultural community, where in Colorado, for example, in addition to natural rainfall, you might need 2 feet on top of an acre of land to bring your crops in every year, hence the notion of 2 acre foot. And that 3 million acre feet imbalance is 10 times what Las Vegas uses now on an annual basis out in 2060. Imbalance comes out of a variety of things, both population growth, but also out of climate change reductions. So here's a quick look at my talk. I want to chat about an overview of the basin quickly, because I know a lot of people in D.C. think the Colorado River is a long ways away. I want to talk briefly about climate change, although Lynn did a terrific job, actually, in her fire hose introduction there, of talking about all the aspects of climate. I want to talk about the two conflicting realities of water management, what the water providers think about it and what the public thinks about it. And I've got three law of the river myths, and I have some solutions. And my cartoon here says, The parent is saying to his son, "One day, son, all of these perfectly good AC adapters, which have long outlived the products they were originally designed for, will be yours." And in case if you don't get it, that's what I'm trying to say, is that we have right now a whole series of laws on the books that are really inadequate for the century in which we find ourselves. So here's a little overview of the basin. 7 different states, 2 nations. An annual flow of 16.4 million acre feet, and I've got some metric units there. You know, the U.S. is in distinguished company in our refusal to join the metric system. Liberia and Myanmar are the 2 other nations of the world that have actually that join us in this opposition. 40 million people, including every major city in the Southwest, depends on it. There's about 5 million irrigated acres. It's about 1/12 of the U.S., this huge topographic variability. That some of the highest mountains in the country are 14ers in Colorado, and we're just outside of Death Valley, the lowest place in the country. And there are 90 years of agreements on this river called the Law of the River, starting in 1922 with the Colorado River Compact, but also there are federal court decrees, Supreme Court decrees, and various agreements out of Congress. And all those areas, all those arrows, those red arrows, indicate places where water goes. So many of which are out of the basin. Salt Lake City, Denver, half the water in Denver is Colorado River water, even though it's on the wrong side of the Continental Divide. Colorado Springs, Santa Fe, Albuquerque, Albuquerque recently decided to get off unsustainable groundwater to get on, quote, sustainable Colorado River water. Or those arrows here in Arizona represent the Central Arizona Project. And I'll talk a little bit about that. 3,000 vertical feet of lift into Phoenix and Tucson, 300 miles. Water goes into LA and San Diego, Las Vegas. The piping here is impressive, what humans have done. So the two largest reservoirs in the United States sit on this system, Lake Mead and Lake Powell. And what I've done here is graph both the contents of the combination of both, all the way back to Lake Mead's filling with Hoover Dam in 1935. And you can see only Mead existed in this period of about 30 years. Then we built Lake Powell, which my uncle actually was the last guy to sign off on in Interior. And he maintained to his dying days that it was a mistake. It was one of the biggest mistakes he did, but that's a whole other talk. And one that doesn't go over very well with the seven basin states. You have this period here of 20 years where we filled Lake Powell, and we had something that looks like normal for about 20 years, a drought. And now we have 14 years of drought, unprecedented. The tree ring scientists tell us that a 1,200-year reconstruction that we can now do shows this 14-year drought to be close, one in five percentiles of recurrence interval on that 1,200-year reconstruction. It's an interesting aspect, this 14-year drought. And what Reclamation just announced about a month ago was that they're going to let less water out of the upstream reservoir Powell for the first time ever, and it increases the probability of the first-time shortage in the system to about 50% in 2015 or 2016. And at the end of this year, water year, which we just reached, you got to go back to 1968 to find a level in these two reservoirs that's comparable. Quite something unusual is going on here. There are two problems in this river system. There's an upper basin problem and a lower basin. And they're really quite distinct. The lower basin problem is that we have overdrawn Lake Mead by about 1.2 million acre feet every year for its existence, based on the law of the river. And the only reason this works is that the upper basin sends down unused water to the lower basin. Were demand to ever grow in the upper basin or climate change reduce those supplies, that 1.2 million acre feet goes away. And we knew this all the way back in 1965. So here's a study that shows this imbalance. And that's the problem in the lower basin. The upper basin problem is really one about climate change and the fact that one section of the 3D of the Colorado River Compact, 3D, requires it to deliver an amount of water to the lower basin every 10 running years. And what people describe that is it gives the upper basin hydrologic leftovers. It means the upper basin has no idea actually how much water they have. And climate change actually makes this even more uncertain. This is an image that came out of the fourth assessment of the IPCC, and the new ones aren't any different, that shows these potentially 10 and 20% runoff reductions at 2050 in this basin. Lynn talked a lot about climate change, and I'm not going to belabor the point except for to make one point to you, which is climate change is a lot more about water than it is about temperatures. Climate change is, in fact, water change. And the best story I heard was an elevator speech that Admiral Titley, who used to run the Navy's adaptation program, told me. He said, Brad, climate change is all about water. It's about liquid water, it's about frozen water, it's about fresh water, and it's about seawater. That's his elevator speech. And if you think about arguably the biggest impact of climate change, which is sea level rise, that's a water cycle change too, right? That's water that's been tied up in glaciers and ice sheets for 100,000-year time frames. It's now being released by these extra temperatures. So the biggest impact is, in fact, water change as well, although sometimes you don't think about it in that way. The reason climate change is water change is because the Earth's system uses the water cycle to mix heat from areas where there's too much heat to areas where there's too little. And it does this in terms of water vapor that moves around, that carries the energy of evaporation with it. And that energy is what powers tornadoes and hurricanes and thunderstorms. And it also does it through big things like the Gulf Stream, big ocean currents that move huge amounts of heat. So climate change is water change, and it's because the Earth uses this water cycle to move heat around. So I live in Boulder, and in the last 15 months, I've had two unusual experiences. So in the left image there is the Flagstaff fire, and that's from my place of work at the NOAA Earth System Research Lab at the time. And we all ran out of the building to look at this, and my coworker looked at me and said, "Have you paid your house insurance?" Nice guy that he is. So that was 15 months ago, and that fire turned out to be not such a big deal, but I was put under a fire evacuation order, as were about 5,000 residents of South Boulder. And then 2 weeks ago, we had the Boulder Front Range floods. And I took this photograph of Boulder Creek, which is one-tenth of its height of almost 5,000 CFS, 2 days after the flood. You know, people love to ask, is this climate change or not? And I would argue that our science is not really right to talk if, when we're dealing with both the question of extremes, are extremes changing? Can we say this is an example? Or do we can we say something about the frequency, how frequency will change in the future? And to talk about these, in climate change, sometimes it's to invite criticism, but man, 15 months, two events, both unprecedented, you know, I have to wonder about this. And my answer is, sure, climate change is at work. It might be 10%, it might be 90%. We're not ripe ready to tell you what, but clearly climate is changing under our watch. All right, so two realities of water management, and I talked about this in the outline. There's the reality of the water management community, and this reality involves what we call in the West prior appropriation doctrine, or first in time means first in right. And under this system, which came about from miners actually, if you were junior, if you're second, if there's not enough water to go around, we concentrate all the pain on one user, the people at the end of the line. And that's prior appropriation. It may not make sense. In fact, I'd argue in some ways it does not make sense in this world. We also have the law of the river, the 90 years of legal agreements. And water management community thinks they know by all these agreements what happens if a shortage were to occur on the Colorado River, which has actually never had a declared shortage ever. Hence the big deal with the reclamation announcement about a month ago that they were going to let less water out of Lake Powell because of this drought and the increased risk of a shortage in the coming years. So you balance that, the reality of the water management community, with the reality of the public. In my experience, the public has no idea what prior appropriation means, and they have no idea the implications of prior appropriation. And they just assume that if water gets short, that however it gets allocated is going to have some fairness inherent in it. That fairness is going to involve equity, it's going to involve some consideration of economical hurt, and it's also going to consider the environment. And when you try and explain prior appropriation to the public, they usually walk out of the room and kind of shake their heads and say, "We don't understand this. You all can do whatever you want, whatever kind of kooky things you can do as long as water comes out of the tap." And my prediction is that this implicit agreement between the public and the water management community falls apart when you begin to have very serious shortages in anywhere, especially the Colorado River. And I want to talk about how this might play out, all right? So here are three law of the river myths with regard to the Colorado River. And I'm going to define myth as a widely held belief that's false. And myth one is that there's a magical level in Lake Mead called 1,000 feet. It's the level at which Las Vegas can no longer take water out of the reservoir where they get 90% of their water. This is a city, modern city of 2 million people. No matter what you think of it, you know, it certainly has a right to a water supply. Law of the river says 1,000 feet means nothing, that we can go right through that 1,000 foot level, we can dry up Las Vegas, we can reduce recreation on Lake Mead National Recreation Area, the fifth most visited national park unit in the country. We can make it so you can't visit Lake Mead. And so that's an ultimate myth. Even reclamation doesn't buy that myth. Their modeling protects 1,000 foot level in Lake Mead. Myth two involves Arizona and the Central Arizona Project allocation. And Arizona's entire cap allocation, which is 1.6 million acre feet, it's more than half of their entire Colorado River supply, is going to be shorted before California gets one drop of shortage. And I'm going to explain more about this, but this is due to a 1968 law that my father and others actually had to agree to get the Central Arizona Project built. And myth three deals with upper basin and climate change, and it assumes that the upper basin takes all the risk associated to climate change, which was not even known about, obviously, in 1922. Well, it was, but the people who negotiated the compact had no idea about it. So let's talk a little bit about CAP. I've mentioned it before, $4 billion to construct, 3,000 cubic feet per second, 300 miles, that huge lift, 400 megawatts to power this thing. And here's where it comes out of the Colorado River at Lake Havasu, runs to Phoenix, and all the way down into Tucson. And that 1968 law, again, in order to get the funding to do this, the state of Arizona agreed that they would short their entire Central Arizona Project canal before California saw one drop. And what happened in 2007 is we agreed to these minor reductions to CAP here, level one, level two, level three, and inside the CAP supplies, they recharged some of it into the ground, so clearly you could cut that off. They have some ag customers, you can clearly cut some of that off. But down here at the highest priorities of CAP, you have the tribes and municipal and industrial customers. And this 1968 law would have CAP get no water. And at the end of the day, Arizona would have 1.2 million acre feet and California 4.4. The discrepancy there, a factor of four. And I argue that this violates our sense of equity and fairness and economics. And I don't know what the agreement is. It's not everything fair vis-a-vis California, Arizona, but you cannot drive this down to zero. You cannot do it in a modern society, and yet that's what our law would have us do. Here's myth three, upper basin and climate change risk. Here's the average Lee Ferry flow, my great-great-grandfather, 15 million acre feet being what we thought, and reductions in it. And here's what Mexico gets as the flow goes down, so basically no change. And here's what the lower basin gets, Arizona, California, and Nevada, no change. And here's the upper basin, what they get, and it goes down seriously. And this is due to Section 3E of the Colorado River Compact. And I argue this is untenable in a world now that we live in. You cannot put the entire risk on the four upper basin states. So if you can't drop me below 1,000, you can't short Arizona, you can't make the upper basin take all climate change risk, you can't ignore power and recreation entirely, there's about 3 gigawatts of power on this system in Meade and Powell, what happens? And I'm going to argue that we're going to find a new way to share shortages. Pat Mulroy, who's the head of the Las Vegas water provider, likes to talk about the term shared sacrifice. That is a far better way to deal with risk in this world in which we live. And I'm going to argue that California is going to have to share somehow in this. And I won't tell you exactly what that looks like, but I will argue that what we have right now does not work. Ann Castle, whose oversight over reclamation and the GS, recently said that reclamation, the states have to do more, do better, do it quickly. You have to balance among the interests. There are meetings underway, actually, to talk about this, and these politics are incredibly difficult, as you might imagine. So here's just some solutions out of the basin study. I mean, Colorado River is or will be water short. You can see the 3 million acre feet. You can increase supply. You can decrease demand. You can change operations. Or you can work on this, at transfers, banking and ag. And I'll tell you a little Mo Udall story. When that 1968 Act was passed, the Central Arizona Project always had it in mind that they were going to import water out of somewhere, Fraser, Columbia, and so they called it augmentation. Well, the Northwest states didn't really take a liking to that, as you might imagine, and Senator Scoop Jackson and others put a rider, actually, in several bills that said you couldn't even study it. And my father ran into Scoop one time, and this story is in his book, Too Funny to Be President, and he said, Scoop, you know, what's the extent of this law. If I'm lying in bed, can I dream about water flowing south out of the Columbia into the Colorado? Is that allowed? And Scoop said, Mo, no. You're not allowed to think about it. You're not allowed to dream about it. The only thing you're allowed to do is forget about it. And my take is that these augmentation plans, there's now one out of the Mississippi of all places, you know, towing of icebergs, they're never going to happen. I'll argue that markets and transfers are critical. We live under this fallacy that water has no substitutes. And both cash and technology are, in fact, really good substitutes for water, in some cases, if users are willing to accept them. This book actually was done by Resources for the Future back in the late 1980s by a reclamation employee, Richard Wall, and it's a good book even to this day. It's 25 years old, and it talks about some of the issues with doing these kinds of water transfers. And then finally, let me talk about Michael Hanneman, a Berkeley economist well-known now at ASU. He has a great article actually in 2009 in Environmental Science and Policy that talks about the game theory implications about coming to water agreements. And his idea, he compares California and the whole CalFed Sacramento San Joaquin Bay Delta system versus the California, versus the Colorado. And the failure in California to come to an agreement because the two parties don't have an outsider kind of threatening to impose a worst case on both of them. And it's a game theory look at how you come at decisions. It's actually an interesting article. And in the Colorado River, Interior actually has that authority. And I would argue they've used it quite effectively to force agreements in a variety of situations. So where's all this leave us? I suggest this cartoon might be a good ending. And here's the basin states getting married. The woman says, I don't mind getting married for better or worse, as long as it's not a whole lot worse. Shared sacrifice, right? Shared sacrifice. So with that, I will end, and I thank you for your time.
I'm going to leave the cartoon up because I may or may not use the one PowerPoint I have. But if I get there, okay. We're supposed to just take a couple of minutes. I'll try to stick to 5 minutes or so. I want to make two points, be a little contrarian, I'm afraid. And the first point I want to make is, even though Brad Udall didn't talk about it, he did refer to a what I'll call a traditional water budget study that we heard from Tom earlier. And I want to make a comment on those. Excuse me. I want to suggest that both studies were technically well executed. And I could quibble, and I would if I wanted to take the time, but I'm not going to, with some of the ways uncertainty has been treated in those and so forth. But I want to make a more general observation about these kinds of studies. These kinds of studies, if you start counting those that have been done nationally over time and at the state level, number in the hundreds, maybe the thousands. And so the question is, why are we doing these things? What difference do they make? I brought here, just as one example, a report called Has the United States Enough Water? It's a USGS report from 1965. And if you went through the recommendations and the reanalysis in this, other than the water quality section, you'd be hard-pressed to find anything that isn't in the most contemporary of these analyses. So the question is, why are we doing them? And I don't really know. I went to the website for the Colorado Basin Study, and it said the following, quote, the study confirmed what most experts already know, that there are likely to be significant shortfalls between projected water supplies and demands in the Colorado Basin in the coming decades. So here we did another study that told us what we already know. So I actually led a study, one of these kinds of studies. I had personal experience for the state of Virginia a while ago. And I was at the Water Resources Council when the second National Water Assessment was done. And as a result of part of that experience, I actually did a study, and the question that was posed was, what difference do these assessments make? And I want to read to you one line from the abstract after we surveyed state water managers around the country with regard to the second National Water Assessment. We conclude the primary value of National Water Assessment stems from the fact that it provides a sense of a unifying general description of the nation's water resource situation and that it serves as a symbolic statement that a rational thought process is guiding national water policy. So I would just say that certainly one of the things that would be interesting to talk about is why we keep doing these studies, just as a, and you can speculate on that. The second point I want to talk about, and here's where I will go ahead and try to use my PowerPoint, and I'm going to figure out how to get to it here in a moment. Let's see, could you come up here and just, it's probably down there, but I want to talk about while we're looking for it. Yeah, that's good. I want to talk about the new kid on the block. Everybody talks about it, but what does it really mean? And I want to talk about this not just in Colorado or anywhere else. I want to talk about it, how it's manifesting itself across the country. Environmental flow is not a term unique to me. I want to suggest to you that these flows cannot be quantified in the sense that they would appear in a water budget, these kinds of water budgets that we've heard about. On the other hand, I also want to suggest to you that they are becoming a powerful concept that is expressed in political and legal venues and not in markets and quasi-markets, and it's dominating the regulatory oversight of most urban water supply planning today. And I'm going to talk to you briefly about how that happens. But in order to do that, you have to know what this means. What does an environmental flow regime really mean, and how does it manifest itself? And I'm going to argue to you that the way it's been argued, rivers have an insatiable thirst. That's what an environmental flow means. Specifically, environmental flows are not about minimum flows. Environmental flows are about the whole hydrograph. They're about variability. They're about the way the river worked historically and how we need to take that hydrograph and put it back in place. Now, if you think about it in those terms, and you think about the fact, and I got quotes here from well-respected aquatic ecologists, but you think about the fact that what we talk about when we talk about environmental flows is a strong dependency of rivers on natural variability, the hydrograph, which you see here in this picture. So let's think along with me for a moment what that means. If the aquatic community had evolved and persisted with the historic flow regime and associated river geomorphology, wetlands, riparian areas is to be maintained, restored, then it follows that the historic flow regime defines the amount of water that a river needs by this definition of the undisturbed state being the definition of an environmental flow. At least as a starting point, environmental flows lay an initial claim to the whole river, not just the flow, but the pattern of flow. And it's in that sense, whether you're in the east, the west, the north, the south, that environmental flows have that effect. So in fact, I don't care where you are, there's no such thing as surplus water. Now let's be a little less provocative and say, water management for human uses, this is a quote, this isn't me, necessarily alters national flow in various ways. However, there is some degree and some type of alteration that will not jeopardize the viability of native species or the ability of the ecosystem to provide valuable products and services for society, the ecosystem services idea. But you'll note in that definition there are no bright lines here. This much water, we can come up with this number. But basically, to implement that, we basically are looking at the issue of when is too much water being withdrawn or consumed. That question is answered in a very site-specific way, in very specific places, with respect to all the other uses in the system. And so when we're talking about environmental flows, we're talking about a new way of talking about the choices we're going to make about how we use our river systems. So how is that choice process actually manifesting itself, and how does this relate? And I'm going to argue that today there is a struggle going on between water utilities, think about them as the people who take the water out of the river, and resource agencies supported by environmental NGOs in both political and judicial areas. And the struggle is to seize, debate terms, the rebuttable presumption. Who has the burden of proof as to what the next measure should be to address water supply, urban water supply issues? And what then, in that burden of proof, is the most practical way to address water supply problems in the urban setting? And I made this chart for another purpose. So on the right-hand side of the chart, as you look at it, if you look at the arguments made as to the appropriate sequence of responses to to water supply shortage, when you start with environmental flow, and it means don't mess with nature and put it back the way it was, this is the order you go in. This is the sequence. And when you get to the bottom, there's a line through it. Don't ever build another dam. Don't ever do any impoundments. On the other hand, I've got safe yield. That comes out of another talk where we talk about what safe yield means to water utilities. But you can get the idea. This is how the urban water folks see it. And you can see how, when you get to the bottom, there's some lines through the things they don't want to talk about. Water system consolidation, reduce baseline water use. And so what we have here going on is who's going to moderate this dispute. And I'm going to conclude by telling you who's moderating it. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers under Section 404 of the Clean Water Act. That's who's moderating this dispute right now. And I suspect most people in this room don't know that, that the Corps of Engineers water permitting program is in effect moderating this dispute over the role of environmental flows versus urban in the urban water planning setting. They're doing it under Section 404. They are conditioning state water rights as we speak, whether you're in the west, whether you're in the north, whether you're in the south, by their permitting decisions. And their permitting decisions are governed by the Endangered Species Act and a whole host of other acts that have to be in compliance with the 404 process. My guess is that we don't know that, but I will conclude by saying I think we're going to be hearing more about this over the next couple of years, the next decade or so, when we start asking, what is this federal agency doing messing with my water planning? And I think that that's happening more and more and more. So I will stop and turn it over to this guy.
Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to comment on the work of today's speakers and associated reports. What I'm going to talk about today is how the reports that we have been referencing today are related to work that water resource economists have been conducting in recent years. So, in the Colorado River Basin report that Brad mentioned, there's a quantification of the potential impacts of climate change on future water supply and demand. But there's also an entire section devoted to potential solutions, options that we have in order to try to reduce the gap between supply and demand that is projected. And there are a host of technological and infrastructure and policy options there. But water pricing and water transfers and water markets are placed within one solution category, and I would argue that it is actually something that interacts with all of the technology and infrastructure options in a way that it could potentially be a cost-effective solution to the shortages that we are expecting in the future. Now, water resource economists have looked at how water tends to be allocated to its most valuable use if there are markets available to trade water. It leads to the cost-effective adoption of infrastructure and technology, and some of the technologies that are considered in the Basin Report are things like desalination, water reuse infrastructure. And so those technologies would be adopted at a time when the value of water is high enough, such as to make those solutions cost-effective. Water pricing would require individuals and firms to incur the marginal cost of water, and that will also encourage the adoption of water-efficient technologies in various sectors. So we think that I think that water pricing should be an important part of the discussion. The reports also lead us to think. So this is my second point. The reports also lead us to think about how. How complex these policies will need to be in order to address the water shortages that climate change is expected to bring about. And I think we have to distinguish what the different kinds of impacts are. So first of all, there are these changes in average expected temperature and precipitation. So policies will need to be flexible enough in order to adjust to that. But in addition to that, we also have expected increases in variability and uncertainty. And so there are going to have to be features of these policies that address that. And then one thing that I think often gets ignored is the role of these spells, that we're going to have prolonged, more prolonged and a higher frequency of prolonged droughts. And I feel like policies that address water shortage will have to address these three different kinds of impacts in creative ways. The reports also bring up this issue of what to do if you have models that tell you different things about what's going to happen. So, you know, how bad the shortage is going to be. Brad was recently involved in a report, that a really interesting report that looks at the reasons why different kinds of global circulation models or land surface models or atmospheric models lead you to such different estimates on what the impacts on stream flow in the Colorado River Basin are going to be. And so we have, you know, once you identify what the drivers are and the differences of the outputs of these models, then the question is, well, as policymakers, how do we deal with that? And so there's some interesting developments in the economics literature. One is some people would call ambiguity analysis. So instead of just trying to optimize your policy decisions based on uncertainty, which is what traditionally economists have done, is to consider this issue of ambiguity. Okay, so not only that you don't know where in the probability distribution of outcomes you're going to be, but you don't actually know what is the correct probability distribution that you're dealing with, right? So this is, these are the outputs of these climate models, right, these distributions, and we have several of them. And so what you do in ambiguity analysis is to assign a probability distribution of the probability distributions. And, you know, this is an ongoing area of research. Our own Roger Cook here at RFF, he's a senior fellow here. He works on structured expert judgment methodologies, which try to measure the performance of expert opinion based on calibration questions and then use those measurements of expert performance to weight the validity, so to speak, of the various probability distributions that are generated. So again, these are interesting, kind of on the forefront of research that I think is highly applicable to the type of information that comes out of these reports. And finally, I think it is important to be aware of behavioral responses. I think that some of these behavioral responses of individuals and firms, which are difficult to measure and quantify, but this should be an important part of the discussion when we look at the conclusions in these reports. One example is there is mounting evidence that promoting efficiency in irrigation technology does not actually lead to reduced consumptive water use. And that is because, A, farmers will reallocate their water use to different crops, perhaps more thirsty crops, and or perhaps increase acreage if they have additional acreage available to them if the irrigation technology is more efficient. Another reason is that a more efficient water irrigation technology will lead to reduced return flow, so all of a sudden the pumping numbers that you're seeing aren't leading to the same return flows. So again, those kinds of what might seem very, you know, detailed behavior responses may have an important impact on your predictions of water demand in the future. So those are my comments, and I hope we have some time for questions.
So I'm looking at our clock, and in theory, we're supposed to be done now, but I would like the panelists to go up, and let's just take like two or three questions. Please, for those who have to leave, please feel free to do so, but both for the panelists who've come all this distance and for all of you who've been so attentive, I thought it would be helpful to at least have an opportunity for a little bit of question and discussion. So any reactions, thoughts, questions that anybody wants to raise? Yes?
It's kind of a comment and a question mostly to Brad. I like what you said about climate change is water change, but to turn it another way, which is to say, with respect to the climate models, is there any evidence that they get any of the water issues right or even close to right? I think, and I just to give my prejudice, I think they get a lot of temperature issues fairly right. I see no evidence that they get any water issues.
So this is Robert or Bob Hirsch of the USGS, a ringer in the audience. Were he still employed by the feds, he'd be a refugee like some of you. No, I think you're right. The models, you know, I have a love-hate relationship with these models, and I think it's the relationship, in some sense, we all need to have. We all need to be skeptical of their output. The last 15 years being a case in point where they're not getting the temperatures right. They don't get monsoons right. They don't get ENSO, this big Southern Pacific Ocean temperatures right. They don't do very well in mountains. We need to have a healthy relationship to them. And I don't, yeah, I'm in agreement with you. On the other hand, we don't have a whole lot to help us looking forward, and so we can't just throw them away and say they're getting nothing right.
So yes.
Part of the Secure Water Act, they mandated the development of the National Groundwater Monitoring Network, which would help us calibrate some of our models a little bit better. So that's a plug.
You know, the whole monitoring side's really critical here. If we don't have very good glasses going forward, we better have glasses going backwards. And it's a non-sexy area. It costs lots of money. USGS gauges are, what, 10 grand a pop to maintain a year. We need to do a better job. Almost everybody agrees on this, and yet getting funding for it is always a tough sell.
Anyone else? I've got a written question or two from those that are viewing on the website. So one of them says, at Downstream 2012, or this is from Downstream 2012, where is the expertise to plan and manage human economies in order to accommodate water's natural courses and cycles instead of the other way around? Anyone want to tackle that?
I won't tackle it, but I think Yusuke's comments, and I think everybody's comments in here on innovative ways to, pricing, with all the caveats, water transfers, interruptible leases, go on and on and on. These are all part of and the permitting process that I alluded to. They're all part of an endeavor to manage people in response to trying to maintain environmental conditions and flows.
Yusuke, did you want to?
Yeah, I would just add that, just saying that you want to implement water pricing, is a lot simpler than what it is, and it needs deep reforms in local, state, and interstate institutions. But, one thing that comes out of these reports is, these conclusions are very big picture conclusions. They're big picture analyses. And so I don't think there's any reason why we shouldn't be considering, suites of options on the regulatory, institutional, and human side of the equation.
So I have a question for our private citizen. It says, due to climate changes, will our private citizen change its assessments from 10 to 5-year period, and of course referring to the Forest Service assessments?
Will the Forest Service change its...
From the 10-year to the 5-year cycle?
Actually, we have... The Forest Service assessment process that I'm part of does have a 5-year update. So we are required by Congress to provide a big report every 10 years, but we also produce a 5-year update. So, in fact, we're currently working on that update. It's to be released in a year or two.
So there's a related question to the Forest Service work and specifically asking whether your models and work basically ask what humans are going to need from water, or do you have a broader look at multiple other kinds of uses or needs from species, et cetera?
It's very difficult to model environmental or ecological in-stream needs well at the spatial scale that we worked at, which is very large basins. So all we did was include a very gross estimate of a minimum in-stream flow that needed to be met, which was equal to 10% of historical mean annual flow. So a very weak attempt at including it, but that really is all that's possible in this kind of study. A lot more is possible when you get down to site-specific situations and start talking to the aquatic biologists and others who can help you at that scale.
Good. Yes?
I wonder what widespread programs are being carried out to educate the man in the street to stop hosing off the sidewalk but use a broom. That water really is precious. Apart from these general uses that you specified in your models, probably just as much as just purely wasted and flowing in the streets or down the sinks or whatever. How can we let the general public know how important it is to stop wasting water?
Yes, okay, maybe you want to talk about that in terms of water pricing and what we know with respect to pricing in that context. I know Sheila Olmsted, who was a scholar here at Resources for the Future, has done a lot of work in that arena and looking at the degree to which pricing actually affects human choices and behavior with water use. But Yusuke, maybe you want to say something about that.
Right. A good portion of the water resource economics literature is dedicated to figuring out this exact question of, you know, what kind of incentives can lead to a meaningful reduction in water use by, you know, different sectors, including individuals in the residential sector. But there is also an interesting part of the literature in the experimental economics field that looks at the role of information and what kind of whether what people know or don't know about the price of the water that they're using or the impacts, how they affect overall water use.
All right. And I'm a PhD economist. I understand that pricing is good, but most of the people who are wasting water all around don't even pay for that water,
right,
or don't realize that the price of water is included in their rent money or whatever, mm-hmm, so they don't know that they shouldn't waste. I don't even flush my toilet every time I use it now that I'm so old.
Right. So for example, there are studies that are being developed that work with smart water meters that will tell you the instantaneous rate of water use that
You know, I'm no expert, but this whole field of behavioral economics, exemplified by two books, Nudge and the book Predictably Irrational, you know, how you get people to do the right things, sometimes it's not at all obvious, and I would argue we don't quite know. I mean, pricing is kind of a hammer, big old hammer, but there are ways, you know, in some communities, for example, water bills that now show how you do compared to your neighbors can be really effective, right? The whole shaming idea actually works pretty well.
I feel compelled at this moment to point to a recent Resources for the Future report. Jim Boyd and Anna Britton and Len Shabman and myself and Tim Brennan put together, and it was looking at the literature across sociology, psychology, experimental economics, a variety of fields, and what increasing insights we have on what motivates human behavior in the conservation context. So go to the RFF website and you can look at that. It's a summary of a broad amount of literature. I think we're going to have to wrap up. We've got one final question and then we'll wrap up in the interest of time.
In your opinions, and several of you alluded to reports of Congress and what guides congressional decision making, what are the ways that experts, scientists, economists, and others convey information to Congress? What's most effective? What could be improved?
Well, I'll make a stab at it, but I don't know. I think that one of the, and I alluded to this in my opening comment, I think that these broad scale, have you thought about this problem kind of analysis has a very short shelf life. You've got to wait till the moment is right, political science is called the face of the issue, and make sure that you're focusing on what is on their mind at the time. And you might have to modify or direct your message in that way. I think that we spend a lot of time doing these studies and reporting out things that to us as analysts look on the face of them. Why aren't they doing this? And I think that that's maybe worth doing, but when the moment comes, you have to be able to seize it. So it's about interaction, and it's about being there at the moment. I think that's part to me. That's my answer.
Thank you.
Can I suggest that the units in which we use to describe water are stupid? You know, we use acre feet, which no one knows. We use million gallons per day. I mean, you'll see reports with billion gallons and trillion gallons, and the meaningless. You know, we count really well from 1 to 10 for some funny reason, and you need a unit typically that fits within 1 to 10 to describe your problem so that people can put it in a better context. I really think we shoot ourselves in the foot. Sometimes I think it's almost purposeful when people use units, you know, trillion gallons, because they're meaningless.
I doubt that there are any members of Congress here today in the audience, but this kind of public meeting is one of the ways, I think one of the very good ways of trying to have some influence, trying to get the word out. I'm not expecting that anyone in Congress is actually reading our government report. I hope they are. I'd be surprised. But maybe they'll hear about it through this sort of thing.
So I
applaud RFF for arranging this kind of opportunity.
Well, I want to really thank our panelists and actually end with another observation myself in response to a different way of thinking about the question that Bob Hirsch asked, the question about how confident we are in the models and the projections, not predictions, that flow from them, and the high degree of variability among them, Brad, as you suggested. And as a kind of policy wonk, rather than a scientist, the lens I bring to that challenge is not necessarily the question of how do we tighten those screws down so the models get better and better. That may be important and worthy of continuing to do. But really, the question is different. It's in a context of high variability and uncertainty, are there policy responses and water management responses that are functional across a broader range of conditions, so that in fact you are reasonably meeting your needs, however those are defined. A second lens that I would bring is some of the challenges described pertain to the interconnected relationship among uses, water systems, water uses, water and energy, water and ag, the list goes on. And that brings me to my keen interest in governance questions. Are there governance structures that better allow us to coordinate and enhance the dialogue across those interconnecting realms? Now, that doesn't yield a necessary and perfect outcome, but at least it sets the table in a way that more of the relevant information is likely to be considered when policies are promulgated. So that's a very different way of thinking about the challenge of models. One is to get them better and better, and other is to say, all right, already there's a lot of uncertainty, but we do know certain things about the decision setting, and that might inform what's relevant or not. I'm going to end on that note and thank all of you for coming. Great audience and really some terrific presentations.